What's going on, YouTube? It's your boy, That Singer Reactions, coming to y'all. This is the Top 16 Awesomely Bad Promos, Part 1. This is Wrestling with Regret. So, we're going to jump into this. I'm sure this is going to be funny because I know a couple bad promos myself that I've seen. And I was like, oh, but it'll be interesting to see what he ranks for everybody's stuff. So, we're going to jump into this. Don't forget, my Patreon is in the description. We get exclusive access, early content, and special requests. You can also do PayPal. You can do Cash App for special requests as well. And also, my P.O. box is in the description. So, send me stuff. I love WWE and AEW stuff. So, hey, if you want to send me stuff like that, I wouldn't be completely mad at you. So, but yeah, let's jump into this. You don't have to send me nothing. But, all right, y'all. Here we go. Play. So apparently this is some dude, but like he's gonna be discussing it. I hope this is like really accurate, like bad promos and not his opinion. I don't know, but Regret, maybe that's his name.
In wrestling, almost nothing grabs your attention quite like a good promo. Mm-hmm. It's the hard sell for fans to buy tickets for the next show or the pay-per-view. It's the first and last part of the great promotional arc, so when you're cutting a promo, it better be a good one. These ones are not good. It's a fact of life that even the all-time masters of the mic have their off days. No one bats a thousand, especially when part of your job is to cut promos of some kind on a near daily basis. But in between the good promos and the bad ones, there lies that nougaty middle where things are so bad you can't help but laugh.
I know The Rock ain't had no bad promo.
These promos are consistently terrible in some form or fashion. It's not just one phrase on its own that makes a promo awesomely bad. There are almost always more elements at play. And over time, these classics become part of wrestling mythology. And for the next 2 weeks, I'm going to rank them my top 16 favorite awesomely bad wrestling promos of all time. Let's do the first eight right now. Number 16, The Miz. What's that number? Oh, Miz, what a long, strange
what
journey
the Miz
been
do?
For you. Though you're one of the most...
I wonder what he do, because I always consider him like a great... Especially now, I don't know what he was.
Testable
like
characters in WWE's recent history, most fans still have a deep respect for you. And hey, after where you started, you deserve every bit of that respect.
Can you bash this?
Oh yeah, that was bad, but I'm talking about a little later on.
I don't know.
July 10th, 2006, Monday Night Raw. By this point, The Miz had spent a couple of years in developmental after coming in second place during the Million Dollar Tough Enough, and had finally returned to the main roster as the host of the Raw Diva Search. Now, these days, we associate The Miz with his impeccable promo skills, his delivery, his timing, his attitude, but 12 years ago, there was almost none of that.
Yeah.
That the sexiest women in the world are the sexiest women on television.
Okay, a bit of a stumble early on there, but just keep going, Mike. We're still with you.
You have to vote. Go to...
No.
Go to WWE. Dial 86946.
Oh my god, that was terrible. I'm so embarrassed right now. Hold up. Jeez.
Sexiest women in the world are the sexiest women on television.
Okay,
he had no script
going on there, but just keep going, Mike. We're still with you.
You have to vote. Go to.
Oh god.
go to WWE. Dial 86946.
Oh my god, I can't look. This is so crazy. Oof.
You could hear the crowd turning on him as he got deeper into the verbal quicksand, but when he finally had to look at the note on his wrist for the number, that was it. Fortunately for Mr. Mizzles, he was able to recover from that botch and keep hosting the Diva Search to its completion. He has since gone on to become only one of the most decorated wrestlers in the company. It's really a testament to his character and discipline. Lesser men would have curled into a ball and died after that Diva Search.
Yeah. Run,
but miraculously, he was able to carry on forth and he proved all the haters wrong. Number 15,
I'm shaming my boy.
Bobby Lashley. Bastard.
Okay.
Remember when Bobby Lashley returned to WWE after WrestleMania?
Okay, so he going the route that I always used to think. I always said I didn't like how Bobby Lashley, he is much better now. But he always had, his voice never matched his look.
34. After being gone for a decade, honing his craft in MMA and Impact Wrestling, people were excited to see him back. But in the weeks that followed, something didn't feel right about him. I mean, here's a guy who was given a big initial push when he first started out, left the company, did better for himself, and then came back. But he wasn't treated like anybody special. I mean, for the first several weeks, he was given no promo time.
Because he was trash.
Wouldn't it be nice if he was given some time to talk and actually explain himself?
Kathy, Jessica, Francis, I love you.
Yeah, never mind, but still better than this.
Bastard.
On a September 2006 edition of SmackDown, Finlay was cutting a promo in the ring. Hornswoggle was also with him, covered in a sheet, making this the first of many times Horny would become the disappointing answer to an intriguing question. Anyway, Lashley cut off the Irishman with a very...
I will always be a WWE supporter because it is attached to my rib, but... it has always had its corny moments.
Bland babyface promo after opening with, at the time, one of the lamest zingers in wrestling history.
You say your name is Finley and you love to fight. I say your name is Finley and you're a bastard.
Oh. I've always found Bobby Lashley's promos a little hard to grade accurately. He's articulate and can be intense when he wants to be, but the sad truth is his voice does not match his amazing physique. It's one of the least intimidating voices in all of wrestling. Had someone with a rougher voice delivered the same opening line, it might have made a difference. But the combination of bad dialogue delivered by an underwhelming voice makes this an immortal promo for all the wrong reasons. And probably one of the reasons they still don't let him talk all that much, even now.
You say you're Irish? Well, your luck just ran out.
Number 14, Roman Reigns, suffering succotash.
Let me say this before we go. They clearly gonna shade Roman right now, but Roman is a promo god right now. That boy is vicious. The look, the delivery, the way he enunciates, everything is right on point.
I do not enjoy piling on Roman Reigns. It's a very tired joke. Though there will always be haters, I can never truly hate the guy because I've always believed the responsibility for his shortcomings lay right at the feet of those in charge of the show, not the man himself. Mm-hmm. And quite frankly, I hope the person responsible for writing this has since been fired for it. In January of 2015, the Big Dog interrupted Seth Rollins
with SmackDown.
This is one of the first major confrontations the two had had since Rollins turned on the Shield and won the Money in the Bank briefcase.
Look at the go, Randy. He ain't making this
now,
list.
Now, when the Shield were first together, Roman was always portrayed as the strong, silent type. He rarely spoke, and when he did, his words counted. So, given the history between these two, you'd hope that whatever Roman says here would be especially profound.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt. I'm not sorry.
Well, yeah, clearly you did mean to interrupt him. They played your music and it took you a dog's age to come to the crowd. The unnatural, unconvincing delivery of that opening statement was bad enough, but then we get hit right in the face with a Superman punch of bad alliteration.
Actually, you're full of something else. You are a sniveling little suck-up sellout full of suffering succotash, son!
First off, that insult is diabolically bad. It's not the kind of sentence someone would come up with.
Oh, it was so horrible. It was so bad, I remember that. God,
Actually, you're full of something else. You are a sniveling little suck-up sellout full of suffering succotash, son!
First off, that insult is diabolically bad. It's not the kind of sentence someone would come up with off the cuff. That's the kind of line that wasn't just written by somebody else. It was co-written by multiple
people. What does that
people,
even
probably
mean?
Probably over the course of several days. Furthermore, all these crossovers with Warner Brothers and not one of them with Sylvester the Cat?
Yeah, I know. That was not easy to say.
Wait, who are you winking at? Who's that a subtle message for? We've begged for wrestlers to acknowledge the camera for years, this is what we get?
I'm cringing. I didn't even realize how bad he was then.
I know! That was not easy to say!
Wait, who are you winking at? Who's that a subtle message for? We've begged for wrestlers to acknowledge the camera for years, and this is what we get?
My so-called brother here, he's got donkey dung for brains.
Now, I understand why he was fed that line. After all, he's related to The Rock, who was the master of idiotic, childish insults.
But he did it good. Let's not. He better. No.
He was able to get away with it, so why not Reigns? Well, as much as I hate to say it, at least The Rock spoke with conviction.
That's what
I'm trying to say is, I'm gonna kick your ass.
Oh, really? That was the underlying message of Suffer and Succotash Son and Donkey Dung? That you were gonna beat him up? Well, forgive me for failing to read between the lines. The one silver lining of this god-awful dialogue is watching Roman cut promos then and watching him cut promos now is like night and day. He'll still say the occasional dumb thing, but at least he looks comfortable when holding a microphone now. Compared to this moment...
Even pause. I don't even know when this was made, but even now in 2021, he's just on top of it.
Reigns has vastly improved in the talking category. From the Shield's debut, it always seemed that Reigns was the one who was groomed for the main event. And make no mistake, WWE absolutely accomplished their goal. They positioned Roman Reigns to be their top guy. But it's always been met with resistance from fans, largely in part to poorly scripted, lame-as-hell promos like this one.
Yep.
In other words, the operation was a success, but the patient died. Number 13, the Shockmaster's debut.
I've talked about
the Shockmaster
before. Are we really putting him at 13? He should be a lot lower on this list, but okay.
A gimmick that was practically doomed from the start just by failing the eyeball test, poor Fred Ottman has been linked with one of the all-time biggest botches. And if falling through the wall wasn't bad enough, then he had to talk. Well, it's not exactly true. He had to mime some hand movements while someone on
stage was talking. I don't even recall him talking. I just remember that
so
part.
So you're the man that rules the
world. Yeah, no, never mind.
They call me the Shockmaster. You want a piece of me? Come and get me. Come after me, Sid.
Though the former tugboat was the one under the glittery stormtrooper helmet, it was actually OG Horseman Ole Anderson who provided the voice offstage, like a really lame version of the great and powerful Oz. I'm guessing Shocky was up standing there silently for so long because Ole was still trying to compose himself. Using his best spooky black scorpion voice, Ole rambled on while Stid did his best to keep the segment going by screaming at the Shockmaster. This is some high-level comedy.
I'm not here for the laugh. I'm not even gonna do it. He said,
this is some high-level comedy. I honestly can't believe how this idea made it to TV.
It should have worked! It should have worked! I know!
Number 12, Michael McGillicuddy, the genesis of McGillicuddy. When you think about it, the original NXT was a great evolution for the business. With a show like that, with guys getting publicly humiliated week in and week out, who needed locker room hazing? Late August 2010 saw the finale of the second season of NXT. The final two men were Caval, better known as Low-Ki or Senshi, and Michael McGillicuddy, the son of Mr. Perfect, grandson of Larry Hennig, and one half of the most dynamic tag team in WWE today. Caval was announced the winner, and that's literally all you need to know
about. Pause, this is old, clearly. One of the best, what do you say, tag teams of today?
Because he did fuck all in the company afterwards. Anyway, Axel was upset by this news, or at least I think he was, since his voice barely changed inflection once he got on the mic. His dialogue sounded like it was ripped straight out of the promo minigame in 2K18's career mode.
Oh, y'all scared.
I am the future of this company.
But this bland, uninspired chatter isn't why you're here, is it?
And starting this moment, from this moment on.
This is the moment. This is the time. When the momentum
and the moment
are in rhyme.
Okay, Mike, finish strong.
This will be the moment, starting now, of the genesis of McGillicuddy.
In defeat, the future Curtis Axel made himself look even worse.
But this is the reason why I'm so good in knowing how people cut promos. I can see the conviction. I can see the way you enunciate. I can see the way you deliver. I can see your tone. I can hear your tone. Like, I can read through a bad actor so well. Like,
one of the most cringeworthy final statements in history.
That was so bad.
Tommy Wiseau couldn't have typed out something that bad. I'm starting to think there may be something to having promos written out verbatim for the wrestlers to memorize.
Come on.
I will admit, I would gladly pay money for a t-shirt with that saying on it.
one of WWE's greatest.
Hulk Hogan, the right gay guy.
Thrown away creations.
For many fans, Hulk Hogan's return to the WWF in 2002 was a feel-good moment. A legend receiving his victory lap in the company that helped make him a megastar. Part of his big nostalgic comeback tour
included
turned out to be a pretty
entertaining... Pause. If we... Overrated had to be invented by him. If you talk overrated, he is the definition of overrated. He is the definition of overrated. He wasn't good on the mic. He wasn't a good in-ring performer. He won the hearts of kids in the world, you know what I'm saying? Because he was just an American guy, you know, but he was just...
entertaining match with Vincent Mann at WrestleMania 19. However, the build came from humble beginnings. After Sylvain Grenier, a Vince-appointed referee, cost Hogan his match with The Rock at No Way Out 2003, the Hulkster had a confrontation with the CEO. In it, the two debated over who made whom. Vince claimed that Hogan was lucky to be chosen to lead the company and took full responsibility for creating Hulkamania, but Hogan disagreed. His focus and energy started off hot, but as he went on, things got a bit rocky.
If you actually think I was just the right guy at the right place at the right time, let me say it one more time.
I'm letting you know this is where the edit's gonna be, brother.
If you actually think that I was just the right guy,
well, you know, I always heard the rumors.
He didn't do it again.
I never would have guessed it with Hogan. And then it gets worse.
I had a match with you a couple of. I had a. Right now, we just settled this because I had a match with a Rock a couple of weeks ago.
You know, I'll bet at that moment...
Jesus Christ.
You know, I'll bet at that moment he was wishing he was cutting one of those old school promos with a Mean Gene. You know, backstage, away from the audience, and with a safety net of editing. It was a humorous stumbling block in the build, but ultimately harmless. The angle between the two, culminating at WrestleMania, was a big hit. It's a good thing, too, because this angle definitely started off on the wrong fat foot. Number 10. Kalisto. Good lucha thing.
Really?
For as long as I can remember, WWE's always been trying to push Latino superstar on SmackDown in order to help boost viewership in that demographic. From Eddie Guerrero to Rey Mysterio to Sin Cara to Alberto Del Rio, capturing the Latin American market appears to be very important to the company. It's hard to believe it in 2018, but there was a time when Kalisto seemed to be the next one in line to get that big push. He feuded with Del Rio and became a two-time US champion as a result. His second reign went nearly 4 months, so it seems as though they were really trying to build something with the guy. But no matter who you strap a rocket to, they're eventually going to have to talk. This wasn't his first time in front of a microphone, but the moments after the 2016 draft has definitely become his most infamous.
Hey, I'm here, like I said before, I'm here to shock the world.
Our partner is going to shock the world.
Poor bastard's already doomed.
I can't stop thinking about Baron Corbin being on SmackDown. I get to have my revenge. Is that scary?
I know that last part was him saying, you know what, in Spanish, but considering how close it was to him flubbing Baron Corbin's name at first, I thought it was just more of the same.
Like I said, I'm here to stay and make a good lucha thing.
Oh, Dios mío.
But here's my thing. He has the character in that little kind of talking goofiness about him that works for him. That messing up stuff works for him. Hogan, I still wouldn't have put that over. Hogan was, I don't know. Yeah, I wouldn't put Kalisto over Hogan as a worse promo cutter. I mean, they're both bad, but...
Kalisto's never been great at talking anyway, so I didn't expect anything amazing here, but the guy could barely get his words out. He was so jacked up on nerves, he got blown up the longer he spoke. But the cherry on top came when Kalisto's skeleton seemed to want to escape his body as he jumped out of frame and yelled out a goddammit woo.
Goddamn woo!
The master of the Salida del Sol never got to become SmackDown's next big star, big surprise, but he would eventually move over to the Cruiserweight division, where he really should have been all along, and beat Enzo Amore to win the purple title late last year.
Enzo.
So it took a while, but he finally did a good lucha thing. Number 9. Eli Cottonwood. Mustache.
Ooh.
One of the hallmarks of the competition era of NXT was the Talk the Talk Challenge, different from the kind of promo you saw our old pal McGillicuddy do earlier. Each wrestler would take turns cutting a 30-second promo, completely improvised, after getting a single word as a subject in only 10 seconds of prep time. Much like everything else in this show, the promo challenge was a test of a wrestler's ability to think and adapt on the fly.
Oh my God.
It was basically a huge training ground for guys to try and occasionally fail in front of the largest crowds they put in front of them. Of all the tasks, the talk-to-talk challenge was often the most unforgiving.
A lot of flowers grow in South Africa. I'm not really a big fan of flowers, but
But in the second season, Eli Cottonwood, an ant in human form, pretty much ruined the fun of the promo challenge for any future iterations after delivering a speech that cannot be topped.
Your topic is mustache.
What is a mustache?
I like how he opened the promo by reiterating the subject matter like it's the topic of a debate piece. I want to see someone open a promo by saying, what is wrestling?
It's a little bit of hair growing over the upper lip. I don't have one.
Really? What do you call that then? I mean, it's not a mustache, but it's enough hair for me to say that's not a mustache.
Nobody else here has one.
You are literally standing in front of two guys who have them. Side note, it's kind of crazy that both those guys are still employed.
See, of all these people here, I have the best mustache of them all.
You just said
Didn't you just say? Did you have
he did.
The? But
he
you
did.
Didn't.
Mm-hmm.
Am I getting swerved?
Yeah.
Give me a couple more days.
He's back.
I'll have a nice, thick mustache. But none of these boys right here.
And that was a passage from the new children's book, "Don't Drink Daddy's Whiskey" by Eli Cottonwood. I mean, I feel bad for the guy. You could see the fear in his eyes. He tried to come up with something, anything to say. What else is the poor bastard going to do? He was saddled with a promo about mustaches. No one was going to make any of these topics work.
He could have said anything. Pause. He could have said, not even Hitler has the mustache that I have. He could have said anything. Don't do Bray Wyatt.
Bray Wyatt was in that same segment. He had to try and cut a promo about doorknobs.
Doorknob.
No.
Well, I used the doorknob to get in here, huh?
And come on, Mr. Genesis himself, Michael McGee, was in this bit as well.
We not gonna do Bray, one of the goats on the mic. That dude has a personality change. He can do it all on the mic. We're not.
And come on, Mr. Genesis himself, Michael McGee, was in this bit as well. I bet he said something stupid, too.
You have 10 seconds to think about the topic of breath.
By the end of NXT, I'm gonna take your breath away.
Well, damn. Never mind. He actually did
a really
good job tying it back. It's just too bad that,
this'll be the moment.
Well, folks, those are my picks.
But me, I'm thinking the same. Because I was about to say, actually, that was probably the best out of the worst. Like, that was the worst. That was the best worst out of the worst.
The most awesomely bad promos, numbers 16
like that was the least,
nine.
Yeah,
join
whatever.
Me next week as I give you my top 8 picks of all time.
Not me flubbing
sure
like I'm cutting
a promo.
Video
if you like it. Comment below. Subscribe to the rest.
I'm going
to
do that.
Making this the first of many times horny would.
You may not have the looks.
Hold on, I'm going to do that right now, buddy, because I'm using your video. So I'm going to comment. I'm going to like. But I just reacted to this. I hope that's okay. I'm just put that was amazing. I ain't even gonna say that. This. Okay. This is an old video. All right. Yeah, that was pretty bad. A lot of the Yeah, promos, all of them was bad. Thank y'all so much for watching, man. Comment, like, subscribe, follow me on my social media platforms. Everything is in the description. Till next video, peace.